This video is to help Math 123 quantitative reasoning students. This is based on our in-class activity on credit cards and APR. I'm going to go over how you would calculate things like finance charges and minimum payments on a credit card. I'm also going to show you how you can quickly and easily do this in Excel by using Excel's drag function. So first of all, if you have your notes from the in-class activities, you will find this example towards the end of the notes. This is where we look at the minimum payment trap whenever you use a credit card. So in this example, we are going to start with a balance of $2,000. We're going to assume there's no additional charges during the billing cycle. We're going to assume an APR, an annual percentage rate of 24.99%. So to calculate the finance charge, we would take our APR, 24.99%, we would make that percent into the decimal 0.2499. And we would divide it by 12 because we're looking at a monthly charge and that was an annual percentage rate. If we take that and multiply it times our balance of $2,000, that will give us our finance charge. The order doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you take the 2,000 and then multiply by the 0.2499. It doesn't matter if you take the 0.2499, divide it by 12, and then multiply. It's all commutative. You might want to get out your calculator and try it yourself. No matter how you enter it, you should get $41.65. That would be our finance charge for month one in this case. Now, the way credit cards work are that if you pay off the $2,000 before your balance is due, you don't get charged a finance charge. But we're assuming here that the person has not done that. That means their new balance would be the $2,000 plus the $41.65. And that is what the credit card company is going to base their bill off of. In this example, we're going to say that you have to pay 3% of your balance. Again, I would turn 3% into the decimal 0.03. I'm going to multiply that by the new balance, the $2,000 plus the $41.65 finance charge. When I do that, I come up with a minimum payment of $61.25. So you can see we've started a table below where we've entered this information to make it easier to keep track of. So you should be able to fill out everything in line one, representing what has happened with our bill in month one. Okay, so let's assume that the person doesn't pay off their $2,000 and they only make their minimum payment. That would mean their starting balance at the beginning of month two would equal the new balance, $2,041.65 from month one, minus the minimum payment of $61.25 to give us the new starting balance in month two of $1,980.40. And then we would start the entire process over. To calculate the finance charge for that month, we would take our 24.99% APR, divide it by 12, multiply it by our starting balance, and so on and so forth. I encourage you to make sure that you know how to do this with just a calculator, because on your test, you're not going to have Excel to help you. But I want to move on to how we can use Excel to do the calculations for us, to help speed things along, and to make it possible for us to look at many, many months in the future. If you scroll down in the notes, you will also see instructions for how to make this Excel spreadsheet. So I'm going to try and match the spreadsheet that's in the notes. And now I've just added the headers to make it look similar to the example that is in the note packet. The reason I really wanted to do this video was to show you the very powerful drag feature that Excel has. I'll show you this starting with the months. We have month one, month two. But instead of sitting here and typing in each consecutive month, I can have Excel automatically fill this in for me. Okay, in order to do that, I want to have my mouse with the big white plus symbol. I'm going to hold down my left mouse cursor and drag it over both of those cells so that they're both highlighted. And then see this little box in the bottom right-hand corner of those highlighted cells? If I hold my mouse over it, the mouse changes to a solid plus sign. When I see that, I want to hold down my left mouse button, grab that corner, and start dragging. Okay, as I drag down, it also was telling me off to the right what the numerical value was going to be. And look how smart Excel is. It figured out I wanted to continue to consecutively number those cells. Okay, the drag feature is very cool. It can also be very frustrating when it doesn't work correctly. So let me show you very quickly some common mistakes that I see. I'm just going to undo that. A common mistake that students make, and even I make it sometimes, is if we just type the number 1 and grab that cell and drag it down, Excel doesn't know that I wanted it to keep numbering. It thought I just wanted to copy the cells and make them all say 1. That's not what I wanted to do. Or what I see students do is they type the 1 and the 2, but they only manage to grab one of the cells. Say I only grab the 2. Again, it doesn't know what I wanted it to do. It just copies that into the cells below. Or if you only grab the 1, again, it just copies 1 into all the cells. So in order for the consecutive numbering to work, we have to give it a pattern to figure out, and we have to grab both of the cells in order to drag them down. Okay, we're going to do something similar with our formulas, but first let's figure out what formulas it is that we need to type into the cells. So I'm going to continue to use the same example we've been using. We had a starting balance of $2,000. I'm just going to type 2,000 into cell C3 then. How did we figure out our finance charge when we did it with our calculator? Now I'm going to ask Excel to do the same thing. Since I'm asking Excel to do a calculation, I need an equals symbol here. And I don't want to type 2,000 here, because while that would work, I want to use Excel's feature of cell references. So our starting balance is in cell C3. And see how it highlights cell C3 to let me know what spot I'm in. I take C3 times something. I have to tell Excel when I'm multiplying, so you actually have to type an asterisk here. You will find that above the 8 key on your keyboard, so Shift 8 will give you an asterisk. And what did we multiply our starting balance by to get our finance charge? Our APR, 24.99, which I make a decimal. That's an annual percentage, so remember, we had to divide it by 12. And when I hit Enter, I get the same 41.65 that we got with our calculator just a little while ago. Let's think about what we would put in cell E3. The new balance, remember, is simply the starting balance. I make sure I type equals here. The starting balance in cell C3. I'm going to add that to our finance charge in D3, and we're calling that our new balance for the month. That'll be if we don't pay off our $2,000 before the bill comes. And finally, our minimum payment. Again, I need to use equals. Now I'm going to take cell E3, times. We decided our minimum payment was going to be 3%, so if I type 0.03 to make that a percent, when I hit enter, I got 61.2495. That's not what we wrote in our table, because we're dealing with money. So let's tell Excel that all these cells are money. So I'm just going to highlight all of our cells that are money. If you have your toolbar showing here, you can just click on the dollar symbol. If not, you can bring your toolbar down, you can expand this if necessary, and find where you can format your numbers to be money, but it's just that simple. Click on the dollar sign, now it looks like money, and now it shows us $61.25. It actually keeps, though, those extra decimals in there for the rest of the calculations. So when you use Excel, if you get a slightly different value than what maybe you wrote on your homework, those little rounding errors are going to be okay. Okay, I have one more formula I have to tell Excel. I have to tell it what the starting balance for month 2 is, because I don't want it to continue to be $2,000. So in cell C4, the starting balance for month 2, remember we wanted to take our new balance in cell E3 and subtract our minimum payment of F3, because in this example, we're looking at the minimum payment trap. That's what our starting balance will be if I only pay the minimum. Okay, so right now you might be wondering why we pulled up Excel to do all the same things that we were able to do with our calculator. Well, watch what I'm going to do next. Excel has this wonderful drag feature where it will try and predict what will be in the next cell. I'm going to grab cell C2 only, grab the corner, and drag it down. Now, it looks like nothing worked, but let's click on some of these cells and see what Excel thinks we want the formulas to be. So in the next row down, cell C5, Excel says, do you want me to take E4 minus F4? Well, yes, Excel, that's exactly what I want you to do. The reason it's giving me that dash, that null symbol, is because we haven't told it what to put in E4 and F4 yet. Okay, so if I click out of those cells and highlight the finance charge and drag it down, it's figured out the finance charge for the next month. And the way the drag feature works is if in cell D3 I was referencing C3, then in cell D4 it says, did you want me to reference C4? And usually that is what we want. I can also use the drag feature across multiple columns, so I don't actually have to do these one at a time. I could select all these values and drag them down at once. And as soon as it has all of the values to reference off of, we now have our completed credit card statement for the first 12 months if we only make our minimum payment. Pretty neat, huh? And we didn't have to do any extra work to get that. In fact, if I grab just the bottom row here and grab the corner, we could drag this out for as many months as we want. So I wonder how many years it would take this person to pay off that $2,000 loan if we just kept dragging this out for years and years. Wow, 530 months, and they still owe $10.93. Of course, it probably wouldn't actually let it go that far, but it's almost like you'd never be able to pay it all off if you just continued this pattern. Okay, that's the simplest version of this example. If that's all you need, that's fine. I'm going to go just a little more advanced on the next page, and I'm going to show how we could also set this up so that we could have a changeable APR and a changeable minimum payment percent. So let me just copy my headers here because that's not going to change. I just started a new sheet. Okay, so that example was pretty neat. The only problem with it was it only worked for that one APR and for that one minimum payment percent. So I want to go just a little more powerful. I'm going to use some of the same tricks I just showed you, like the drag feature. So remember how I just did my months. But I'm going to create some extra labels off here to the side. So for instance, I could create a spot for the starting balance, a spot for that all-important APR, a spot for the minimum payment percent. Could make them look neat, make them in bold, put some outlines around them. Okay, those are just my labels. So in the cell next to them, let's give some values here. 2,000, let's make it dollars. Here, APR is a percent. So I'm going to type it as 0.2499. And then if I come up to that cell and I click on the percent symbol here, it will write it as a percent. Now, if you don't like that it rounded it to 25%, remember you can expand this number formatting, and you can add as many decimals as you would like to see. Same thing for the minimum payment. I'm going to make it 0.03 and then click on the percent symbol so it looks like a percent. I'm going to use all the same formulas that I used earlier, but because I'm referencing these cells, remember the way that Excel used our drag function. So if I type equals cell I3 here, it will reference that cell. The issue though will come in when I use the drag function, because what Excel is going to think is that I want the next cell to reference not off of I3 but off of I4, and the next one to reference off of I5. So you can see again where this feature can be very frustrating when it doesn't work correctly. So to get around that, I am going to give these cells variable names. When I click on the cell for starting balance, it tells me up here it's cell I3, but you can actually change that cell reference and make it something fixed. So for instance, this is our starting balance, so let's call it start bal for starting balance. Now I can use starting balance basically as a variable in my formulas. Same thing for APR. So in the box where I have my APR, I'm actually going to label it APR. Very useful. And cell I5, I'm going to label it something to represent that it's minimum payment. Okay, I wasn't sure if it'll let me name it min or not, because that's also a function name. So again, in cell C3, I can now use the variable name startBal. And look, as I start typing it, it even says, hey, is this the one you want? You can click on it to say, yes, it is. Actually, let's come up to this and make it dollars here. Make it look nice again. To do my finance charge,
Well, my finance charge, I want to reference this off of cell 3 for when I use my drag function in a little bit. And remember, it was cell 3 times. Now, instead of using a fixed APR of 0.2499, I'm going to use the variable name APR, which now points to this cell. Remember, we have to divide that by 12. Our new balance formula actually doesn't change. It's still C3 plus D3. Our minimum payment, I still want to take cell E3. I want to multiply it by the 3%, but maybe I don't always want it to be the 3%. I want to multiply it times the variable named min. So here's what I was warning you about. We named it min. It's asking me here, do you want the function minimum or do you want the variable min? We want the variable min. One more thing to tell Excel. I'm still going to tell it for cell C4 that I want to take cell E3 minus F3. So again, so far maybe you're thinking, all right, we did all of this a little while ago, but I do have a reason that I want to do it this way. Yes, we get the same table we just had on the last page, but now I have this cool feature where I can come over and easily, quickly change values of, say, my APR. So maybe I have a different credit card offer. They're not going to charge me 24.99%. They're going to charge me 20%. By changing that cell, everything else is referenced off of it, and it automatically changes. Same thing for my minimum payment. I want my minimum payment to be a little higher than 3%. I want it to be 5%. How does that change my balance over the next 12 months? I even made one for my starting balance. Let's say we only started with $500. So this could be a really cool tool to use to figure out how different credit cards would charge you, or maybe how different car loans would charge you. And you could look at how your payments would be changed over any number of months that you want. So I encourage you to try this out. It's not that hard. It does take a little bit of practice, though. I hope this video helps you.